All right, let's see if we can call to order. It is a little bit after 8:30 in the morning, and this is the meeting of the Legislative and Human Resources Committee of the Kent County Board of Commissioners. We will begin with our public comment opportunity. If there is anyone from the public, either live or attending virtually, that wishes to address the committee, you may do so if you'll identify yourself, and you have 3 minutes. I see no one live in the meeting seeking to address the committee, and I suspect there is no one online. All right, let's move to item number two, which is approval of the minutes from June 22, 2021. Is there a motion to approve?
Moved.
Is moved and supported. Support. They're all at once. Very good. Any comments, questions? If not, all that support that motion say yes.
Yes.
Opposed say no. It is approved. All right, Dr. Cole, I see him here. Welcome. Next item is a performance measurement review presented to us by our chief medical examiner, Dr. Cole.
All right, thank you for having me. I guess I don't need a mask.
Well, legal counsel is next to me, but as far as I'm concerned, you don't.
Okay, that's good enough for me. All right, so we'll just get to it. Oh, we have a technical person, or technically oriented. So there's the kind of the fight about this is just alignment with the priorities and goals. Okay, good enough. Thank you. Clearly, you don't have to be here. Maybe the next person, whoever replaces me sometime, will. Our goals, anyway. This is kind of elucidation of the obvious here, but we are supposed to do. Not everyone, and I'll try not to go too long on this. This isn't everyone who dies, but individuals who die of any kind of trauma, so accident, suicide, or homicide, people who die suddenly and unexpectedly, for example, dying at home and their death is not imminent, or wasn't thought to be imminent, we investigate those cases. But what we do as part of our investigation, every case that we accept as a medical examiner case, we have investigators who will gather information. They will report to either me or Dr. Start, the deputy chief medical examiner. We take turns being on call. And then we will make a decision, Start or I will make a decision as to whether we're going to do an autopsy. We do so in about 30% of the cases that are reported to us. The remaining 70% of cases We feel we can get enough information that an autopsy is not needed to determine. Our investigators, in every case that we accept, produce an investigative report and summarizing the disposition of the case and what happened and how the case came to us. And then if there's an autopsy, then Dr. Stard or I, whoever is completing the autopsy, will do so. And in a timely manner, I think we probably have some metrics here that will be more specific. In other words, our turnaround time. As part of that, goal number three, we try to respond as promptly as possible when we are called. The individuals who call us are either going to be the police, that's very often the case, because someone's dead at a scene or a home, and a police officer may be called, so they will be in charge and they will initiate the call. In the remaining cases, it'll be a hospital, or occasionally a nursing home or hospice. But if those individuals who die, usually it's either definite or suspected trauma. Call us, and we will decide if it fits our criteria. Try to respond to these calls promptly so that the police aren't stuck at the scene waiting forever to hear back from us as to what we're going to do. Should get a ticket. I was going the wrong way. Anyhow, performance metrics. Again, I guess matters. Really a high quality of work. Doing death investigation and trying to identify situations or might be communicable other way or inherited in some families. Tested. Loved one. Then our mission is the third category there. Feedback from the public when they contact us. I might give just one brief example of number three. Last year we had a case of a little girl, I believe she was 4 years old. She had about a 1 week history of having bloody diarrhea and just not feeling well. Her siblings had the same symptoms. This particular girl was taken to a local hospital, evaluated in the emergency department. They decided she wasn't that sick. They released her, and the next day she was sleeping with her mother because she was sick, and the mother found her dead. So we did the autopsy and found that this child had a very infectious type of diarrhea due to an organism called E. coli, but not just regular E. coli, a pathogenic type of E. coli. We identified that on testing of the bowel contents in our lab at Spectrum, referred this to the health department, they referred it to the state, ultimately to the Centers for Disease Control, and it turns out that there had been several other cases around the country of the same type of E. coli, although none other ones in Michigan. The siblings fortunately recovered, and I think the father had similar symptoms. But this is an example of we identified a very dangerous and infectious disease, got it to through the public health department, referred it to them. Family was followed up with, and fortunately the So that's just an example of how we operate. Had to complete our report. Autopsies in a time. One way we go about quality control internally is each of the, I think it's about 1,200 investigators report. I review just to make sure that they have the right information, that major errors. All the reports are reviewed. Also have a monthly conference in which we review all of the autopsy cases for the prior month. So it's a PowerPoint presentation. Our assistants assemble this presentation. We have a history, then we have the relevant autopsy photographs, all of the toxicology, and then ultimately the outcome of the case.
Dr. Cole, can you bring that mic just slightly closer to you?
Oh,
when you turn, we lose track of where you are.
Yes, certainly. How's that?
Very good.
Well, I'll try to keep looking, keep my face near
this. Or just rotate around. There you go.
A couple of accomplishments. For off and on, but mostly on, for the past 18 years, we've been certified. We've been a medical examiner office that's been certified by the National Association of Medical Examiners. This is a quality control program nationally run by our primary organization for forensic pathologists. And there's a long list of items that they evaluate, including the quality of our reports, many of the things I've talked about here, the turnaround time, our facilities, which I might add are actually rather pathetic, and sooner or later will have to be replaced, I suspect. But we've managed to scrape by on that. And just generally, how do we compare and with having a quality run medical examiner office compared with others around the country? And we're one of roughly 30 offices that has been accredited. There are probably another 70 or 80 that have not. Another accomplishment is that we cooperate with Gift of Life, which is the organ harvesting, organ and tissue harvesting organization out of Ann Arbor. It's for the state of Michigan. And they are very active and aggressive about harvesting tissue and organs after someone has been pronounced dead. And we are the top county percentage-wise, and almost the top county. I think Wayne may be a little ahead of us in total numbers, but percentage-wise, we're the number one county. And the Gift of Life folks very much appreciate the efforts that we make. It's often, sounds trivial, but it can often be very inconvenient dealing with them. We have to delay doing autopsies if they're going to do a tissue harvest and that sort of thing. But we think ultimately that it's worth it this is one way we can help living individuals. In addition, they acquire the autopsy results. When we do an autopsy on a patient that has been harvested, they need those results to make sure that we did not identify something that would be of concern to a potential recipient of the tissue. So, what are issues that we are looking to deal with in the future? Most people probably have heard of fentanyl, which was, it still is, a very, very commonly identified, the most commonly identified drug in an overdose. The clever clandestine chemists around the world have managed to alter fentanyl, add a chemical group to it here and there to perhaps increase its potency. It's already far more potent than heroin. But identification of these drugs is an issue because some drug screens that may identify fentanyl don't identify some of the variations of fentanyl. One of the most recent ones that we've encountered is perafluorofentanyl. And so we try to keep up with this. And from the medical literature and public health sources and so on, what drugs are being identified. The COVID pandemic has affected us to some degree. Many patients that die of COVID are diagnosed prior to death. So they're diagnosed, usually hospitalized in the intensive care unit. Those are not our cases because those are not sudden unexpected deaths. But we have had a number of deaths that occurred, one in a veteran's home, a man that had symptoms but wasn't known to have COVID, and so we did the autopsy and diagnosed him. We had a woman, a 35-year-old, was one of the first ones that we autopsied, that actually, rather than lung disease, her main problem was a severe inflammation of the heart that caused her death. And we had a 19-month-old recently that died who had both lung disease and heart infection. So mainly it's our issues have been that we've tried to have an active surveillance for COVID. If anybody had symptoms of COVID, dry cough, fever, shortness of breath, we can do a COVID test actually post-mortem, the nasal swab that they do on living people. And so we will certify those deaths as COVID-related if the symptoms and the pathology and the serology are consistent with COVID. We do have some issues with occasionally getting our investigators to scene calls. We try to send an investigator when someone is dead at the scene, particularly if they're young, if it's a drug overdose, or if it's a violent death, such as a motor vehicle crash or suicide or homicide. So we, in the summertime, even though we have a total of 8 investigators, it's been a challenge. Each of our investigators is basically a contractor. They don't get any benefits, and they don't have to take a shift. We have an exchange of operators that whenever there is a call, these operators have to find somebody, whoever's available, and that can be a challenge sometimes. And I mentioned earlier our facilities. The current morgue, I remember very well, back in 1985, when the morgue, which has always, at least ever since I've been around, has been a Blodgett, they had a new morgue, and we had a grand opening for the morgue and invited a bunch of friends and officials and so on, and that was 85, and the equipment we have there is still pretty much the same. So, and it leaks and breaks down and so on. Let's see here. Any questions?
All right, surprise. So thank you for that. I suspect we have some questions. Yes, Mr. Ponstein.
Thank you, Chair Stack. So the issue of people that die in Kent County that don't live here, we're responsible for those costs. Has that been rectified? Any
well,
work on that?
There's really nothing to be done. So the question, just to repeat, is somebody, say, from Ottawa County comes over here and it's injured and dies in a crash or overdoses or whatever, the county of death is the one that's responsible for investigating the case and whatever expenses there are, which is an autopsy is the biggest one, then that county of death is responsible for it. However, we have had luck in the past, and I think we still do, with Ottawa County where someone is injured there and is shipped, say, to Butterworth or one of the other hospitals here in Kent, and they don't live very long and they die. Technically, it's our problem, but and this is under Dr. Mack, my predecessor, he managed to do this, that Ottawa will agree to pay for the autopsy. They don't have to do it, so don't tell anybody in Ottawa. No, but no other county does that. And it's just part of our situation is having a large medical center here that gets patients from all over, sometimes all over the state, and they die here. And if it's a traumatic death reportable to us, we just have to do it if we're going to do an autopsy.
So what percentage of the budget?
Well, okay, if we're talking people injured or taken ill in another county and then they're shipped here to die, which sometimes is about what happens, and we have the responsibility of investigating those deaths, I would say about a third to a fourth of them, probably, of our total caseload.
Yeah, Commissioner Hennessy.
You spoke of increasingly inadequate facilities, and at one point, I think you said My Spectrum Health or something referring to where you do work. So talk to me about, you know, the facilities you're using, the possible conflicts of interest, if there's ever been any, and, you know, where do you see your department having to go in 5, 10 years? I mean, give me provide an outlook for what we need to be doing and thinking about.
As they say in court, that's a compound question.
Of course it is.
But I'll do what I can.
They're allowed in this court.
Yeah, okay, good. All right, yeah, fine, okay. The physical facilities, I don't know exactly how many square feet. I think it's probably around 900 or 1,000 square feet that we have. Again, we have two, I won't go into excessive detail because we don't have all day, but we have two ancient autopsy tables that we've always had. The problem that besides having old equipment, and occasionally the morgue gets flooded because the sewer gets blocked up and we've waded around in sewer water on occasion. The engineering department at Blodgett has been responsive and done the best they could to fix that kind of issue, but when it happens, you're stuck, especially on a weekend. So there's that issue. Size, just sheer size is a problem of the autopsy room. Now that COVID, well, I don't know what's going to happen with COVID, but if COVID ever loosens up, we often have, as we did yesterday, police officers or evidence technicians that come into the morgue to collect evidence. Well, we're all running into each other. If we got two autopsies going on, say two homicides, Start and I each have our own autopsy table, and we're doing the case, and we're collecting evidence. We got two police agencies there. And sometimes we have students, med students, and so on. There, people are running into each other just because it's, you know, so small. We do have pretty adequate body storage coolers, I would say, facilities. But an ongoing issue is we always have plenty of unclaimed bodies. Families, either there is no family or quite frequently the family just doesn't want to have anything to do with the body. So that's somewhat of a logistic issue, is moving those bodies around and making room. Let's see, that's kind of a brief overview of the facilities. Before we get to long-term thoughts, did you have another part of that question?
Well, no, I would like you to address, you know, how you think we should be thinking about this. As, you know, we do, you know, capital improvement projects every year. We do facilities planning, and we keep updating that all the time. So give me an idea. What do we need to be thinking about in your department?
Well, yes, I can share thoughts about that. For those older timers who've been around for a while, in 2008, we were on the verge. The county was on the verge of building a new morgue. We had an architect, we selected plans and all that. Well, then the crash hit, and so that scuttled that. But the need still is there. So we're going to need, in my opinion, now I'm not going to be still working. I hope I'm around, but I probably won't be working in 5 years, maybe, but certainly not 10. But I predict that we're going to need a new facility. I was thinking an ideal one, just for what it's worth, is where the State Police Crime Lab used to be, next to the health department. But somewhere, a preferably centrally located facility, the cost, we'd probably be looking at $20 million, $30 million, I would guess, but but that would have to be more carefully determined if we're going to move forward. But a space where there's an entryway, and again, I won't get too specific, but an area for families to sit. We might even be able to allow families on occasion to view their loved ones. Right now, the hospital and our office discourages that as much as possible because we just don't have a place to do that. We don't have a safe, respectful place for families to come in and look at their loved ones. We might have some laboratory space now. Everything is done at Spectrum Labs. But I would say probably we're looking at a minimum of $20 million, I would think. But I think really, when I'm out of here and we're looking hopefully to recruit a young, competent replacement, we'd have to have a facility that would be attractive to them. I mean, I will say honestly, I think Grand Rapids is a wonderful place to live, and we have great education and a lot of good things, a lot of good beer and stuff, but you got to have a facility that someone who's out of training wants to look forward to say, you know, hey, that's a good physical location. And I think basically my opinion is forever up to this point, Spectrum has provided a morgue that the county didn't have to provide. I think it's been a lot cheaper, which is fine. As a taxpayer, I'm all over that. But it hasn't been adequate. And Spectrum doesn't have any motivation to build the facility that we need. So I think we've gotten away sort of on the cheap for a long time, and it's just going to take someone to bite the bullet and say we're going to just have to build an adequate facility for an area, what are we, about 700,000 people here in Kent County and surrounding counties that we actually serve.
You have a follow-up?
Yeah. Sure, I'd like to follow up. So I appreciate that, and I was a part of the group that was still here in 2008 that we were put you on our, you know, we were saving money at that point to put you into an independent facility, and so here we are late, you know, 2021. But our population has certainly grown over that period of time, too. So how is, you know, there's not a lot of numbers to today's report, but what is happening in terms of the numbers of cases you're taking on? And you talked a little bit about the impact of COVID, but maybe you can flesh that out a little bit.
So to speak.
Because keeping up with your sense of humor. to talk about, you know, you usually don't examine the deaths that are more predictable that are in nursing homes or in hospitals, in care facilities. But how has COVID impacted that? Because there are more, like you talked about, a disguised death, one that you didn't know until you had looked into it. And you know, maybe you can just talk a little bit more about that whole impact of COVID and just the impact of population growth.
Okay, we'll start with COVID. So COVID really hasn't affected our particular little department as much as it has the community at large. And that's because, as we both talked about, many patients that die of COVID-related illness are diagnosed and hospitalized and so on before they die, and so they don't actually fall under our jurisdiction. But I'd say the big issue for us is the number of people who die out of the hospital, out in the community, and that maybe had symptoms. Now, if we have a person with, just as one extreme example, say 70-something years old, several heart attacks, emphysema, and they die at home and maybe are found dead there, and if they didn't have symptoms of COVID, we're not going to test them and we're not really concerned. We'll just sign, you won't even do an autopsy most of the time because the death is somewhat expected. But the ones of the deaths of people who are, say, a little younger and who had these symptoms of COVID, the dry cough and fever and shortness of breath and so on, we're getting more of those, and I don't have numbers right now on how many we've tested and maybe not autopsied. We've probably autopsied 10 or 12. in the past year and a half, COVID patients. Again, usually younger, and there was a lot of uncertainty. And the man who lived in the veterans facility, there was concern about other occupants of the veterans facility, and we just wanted to make sure. In fact, he did have COVID. So I would say surveillance. If in a word, surveillance for COVID has been how we've been affected, and we've had to get kits and so on for doing the nasal swabs, and it does take extra time to do that. But that's probably our main concern. I'm not concerned, and there are no cases, by the way, that I know of any individuals working with deceased persons, that is in morgues, funeral homes, whatever, of getting COVID. We're not worried about getting COVID from a dead person, so that's not really an issue, but just trying to identify it. And even if we don't do an autopsy, there's a few that we've identified that had COVID, and we didn't do an autopsy because their symptoms were so compelling, but we still certify those deaths as COVID, and we try to keep up with what does the State Health Department and the CDC, what cases do they want us to report as COVID? And it's basically anything in which there's a possibility of COVID, that their symptoms or something to suggest it. So, let's see, I think the second part of that was the case numbers, stuff like that.
The population growth that we're experiencing, you know, in Kent County and even in the region around us.
Well, that relates, ultimately translates to us as case numbers.
Right.
Which is the way I would, but so now Carmen, who is here, our office administrator, every year compiles, and I think she's just finished the 2020 annual report, and that has the specific numbers, and I think everybody will probably get one or certainly is welcome to a copy of that. But I would say over the last several years, it's our total case numbers have increased. Now we actually have, I mentioned the cases that are reported to us that we accept as autopsy or accept as a case. We don't always autopsy them, but it's a traumatic death. We have to sign the death certificate and investigate it. There's that number of cases, which is about 1,200, and that would include that includes the 30% of that 1,200 that are autopsy. Well, we also have about another 600 or 800 cases, so we're around 1,900 total cases a year, so another 600 or 700 on top of the 12, and those are cases which are reported to us, but which, after we look into it, really don't qualify as a medical examiner case. Nonetheless, those take time to ferret out and make sure that it is not a medical examiner case. A part of our caseload also is relates to one of our, which wasn't mentioned today, one of our missions, which is to sign cremation permits. Every time there's a cremation permit, we have to at least review the death certificate to make sure it's not a case that actually needs to be autopsied, for example. But we have to make sure that the cause and manner of death are properly certified, and then sometimes they're not, so we have to chase down the doctor who signed the death certificate. And we had a case recently where the cause of death was certified as something like cerebral hemorrhage due to colon carcinoma. Well, that doesn't make any sense. So we have to look into that and figure out what did you really mean or what's going on here. So, but the short answer is the increase in population results in an increased number of cases that we have to handle. So it's our workload increases. And in all areas, really, more cases reported, more complex cases, and more cremations, and so I would say that's how it affects us.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you.
Any other commissioners? Yes, Commissioner Coleman.
Thank you, Chair. What's the remaining term of the lease or whatever with Spectrum for the existing facility?
About every 3 years that there's there are contract talks. I don't work for Spectrum, by the way. Oh, the conflict of interest. I'll talk about that in a minute. I work at Spectrum, but not for them. So I'm in a group of pathologists that contracts both with Spectrum and actually with Kent County in this for medical examiner work. But it's about every 3 years. I would imagine if in the middle of that term if the county decided, hey, we're going to build a facility, Spectrum would just have a celebration. I think they'd be real glad, and I don't blame them. I mean, you know, they'd be glad to get rid of us. I'd be glad to get rid of me as well, I'm sure. But along with Spectrum and conflict of interest, there is a potential conflict of interest for us doing cases, you know, say somebody dies in at a Spectrum hospital, and maybe there's a potential or definite therapeutic mistake, a malpractice kind of thing. Well, people might say, hey, you know, to me, you have a reason to kind of stay in good with Spectrum, so just overlook it or something. And that is potentially that, you know, I couldn't deny that there's that relationship that I have, but we've never had a problem yet. We've never really been accused. And so I'm hoping to keep it that way, but I would acknowledge, yeah, that there is a potential, and having a morgue, an independent morgue, would at least alleviate any concerns about that for sure.
Any other questions? If not, I do have one follow-up, Doctor, to some of these questions about your facilities. I think the technical term you used was pathetic.
Technically, yes.
So, in your opinion, how imminent is it that we need to take a look at a significant restructuring of that system?
Well, one thought I have is, you know, in general, the sooner the better. It's one of those things is we're kicking the can down the road. You know, we can get by, you know, with what we have. We have for, I think it's the so-called county morgue has been at Blodgett for 40 some years. So we can get by, but it's just as time passes, there are going to be more floods, you know, sewer water floods down there and so on, and the equipment. And I'm not, again, I'm not blaming Spectrum because we're not a moneymaker for them and they're just kind of putting up with us. But they're not inclined to replace our aging equipment. Maybe the real key point could be, again, I don't have a definite retirement date, at least voluntarily, that I would retire. But at any rate, I might go on for 3 years or something like that, but probably not a lot longer. And then we're going to, again, and Dr. Start, he's younger than I. I don't know if he's what his plans are. Mm-hmm. So he is sort of the heir apparent, subject to getting appointed by the commissioners to be the chief ME, but nonetheless, they're going to have to at least recruit a younger person, and Start isn't going to last that much past me. And I, as I said earlier, I think just one issue is just getting a one issue, not the only issue, is getting a young person in here that would want to stay here potentially for years, and that's at the top of his or her game, and having a good facility. And if there's what we have now would not be attractive for that.
Okay, so if the process is about a 3-year process, and maybe that's as fast as it could go.
Right. Right.
You're suggesting we're kind of at the cusp of critical.
I think so, because yeah, it's going to take quite a while to arrange for the facility and to get it built and all okay. that sort of thing.
All right. All right. Okay, thank you. If there's no other questions, we appreciate your report.
And, sure, thank you.
Look forward to hearing from you again next year.
Me too. Planning to be here still. But yes, unless nature takes its course, I'll be here next year.
Very good. Thank you. All right, let's move to our next item, which is a request for some additional positions from Corporate Counsel, Circuit Court, and Health Department. Jenny?
Thank you. This action request is a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners to add an Indigent Defense Administration Analyst in the Corporate Counsel's Office for Youth Specialists at the Circuit Court and a Deputy Administrative Health Officer at the Health Department. The Corporate Counsel's Office is requesting a full-time Indigent Defense Administration Analyst to comply with the current Michigan Indigent Defense Commission Act. The cost of this position, approximately $81,000, will be included in the proposed Indigent Defense Fund budget and funded by the state of Michigan. Second, the Circuit Court is requesting 4 youth specialists to comply with Public Acts 97-114 of 2019, which require services be provided under the juvenile justice system when a court exercises jurisdiction over a juvenile who is 17 years of age at the time of the offense. The cost for these positions, approximately $268,000, will be included in the proposed child care fund budget and funded by the state of Michigan. The health department is requesting a deputy administrative health officer to backfill for the position, which was transferred to chief inclusion officer. The cost of this position, approximately $154,000, will be included in the proposed health fund budget and is funded 30% by county general fund and 70% by grants, fees, and reimbursements. If funding is eliminated or decreased, the positions will be eliminated unless continuing funding is approved pursuant to the fiscal policy on grants, contracts, and donations. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve a resolution approving these positions?
So moved.
It is moved. Is it supported?
Support.
And supported. Any questions? Yes, Commissioner Ponstein.
Thank you, Chair Steck. So in the Circuit Court one, it says that the proposed child care fund, and it'll be funded by the state of Michigan. What are the guarantees that, I mean, or how much is it? Is it fully funding it, partially, and is there any guarantees that they'll continue to do it?
Andy, can you maybe respond to that? Andy Thalheimer.
Okay, so your question, I'm sorry, I was walking up and I was given last minute instructions to close this computer screen, so could you repeat it, please?
So the funding of the positions, it says it's going to be funded by the state of Michigan. Is that 100% partial? What does it look like going forward? Is it going to be something that becomes an unfunded mandate?
Right. It's a very good question. The way the law reads, the way we're understanding it as court administrators, all my colleagues, is that for the first 3 years, the state is going to be keeping track and paying 100% of these services that we're providing for these kids that are 17 years old that we wouldn't have before. After that 3-year period, they're going to do a look back, and what my understanding is they're going to try to change the reimbursement formula of the child care fund. Right now it's 50-50. They want to change that to accommodate what it costs for 17-year-olds to make it more, goal is that, yes, we're not supposed to be affected by it, according to the state. But that's how they're proposing to do it at this point. So right now, we keep track of all our 17-year-old costs and report those somewhat separately to the state. And then in 3 years, they're going to look back and see what the total cost is and change the reimbursement formula.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Skaggs.
Thank you, Chair. So I guess it would be nice moving forward, but so what does an indigent defense administration analyst do?
Greg, you're going to respond to that one for us, Greg Paul?
I'll do my best. So under state statute, certain responsibilities that the Circuit Court now performs are going to be transferred to the Corporate Counsel's Office under Indigent Defense Administration. So we're going to be keeping track of the number of appointments. We're actually going to be issuing appointments. Instead of the court, we're going to be reviewing and approving invoices. We're going to be appointing and approving invoices for experts and investigators, and potentially dealing with the issues revolving around attorney fees. And then, of course, because it's a state grant, there's a bunch of reporting requirements that go around, along with that. And we will be, the person will be assisting in doing that reporting.
So was this a position at the Circuit Court or in the court system?
There's a person that does that work today. I'm not certain what's actually happening with that position in terms of the Circuit Court budget. The position, we're creating a new position in Corporate Counsel's Office that's different. Some of the responsibilities are not the same.
Okay.
So I'm not sure, frankly, what's happening with the position in the Circuit Court budget.
Okay. I mean, I get that it's funded by the state of Michigan. I suppose it would be, I mean, if we're having a transfer, I guess it would be interesting to know what's happening to the person whose job appears to have been eliminated, or at least the purpose of the job appears to have been eliminated. Okay, then.
Maybe Andy can respond to that.
Okay.
But he's walking up, so that suggests that he can.
Yeah, we do have a position right now in our case management department that does, I guess, a lot of these duties. We were planning on giving that person more duty, so to speak, with case management, especially as we're moving towards things like e-filing and new things going with the SCAO requirements, statutes, just kind of moving forward and with our case management.
Do you have to come back before us and get approval for that position, or since it's a rollover?
The circuit court position is already in position description. It's not being eliminated. So that would be dealt with by Andy and his budget as to what that person would spend their full-time hours doing. The new position at Indigent Defense is because there is no indigent defense analyst in position description at this point, so we needed to create that position, and then the funding comes from the state for that new position.
Okay, well, I guess when we hear from you again, Andy, it'd be nice to know what you put this person, had this person doing. Then moving on to the circuit court, what does a youth specialist do?
Specialists are our direct care workers out at juvenile detention.
Okay, so, is there any more explanation about what they do? I mean, is this a corrections officer? Is this a social worker?
Well, I guess it kind of be a mixture of both. They're obviously specially trained to deal with juveniles, 16 and younger now, to be 17 and younger, to deal with, kind of provide direct care. I mean, our licensing requirements is that we have two people in each unit, two youth specialists in each unit. It's a 24/7 operation, so three shifts. So we can absorb, I think, with our current capacity, a lot of the 17-year-olds. But we also want to increase our residential treatment population out there, which requires a little bit of specialty training with the youth specialists to handle those units. So that's basically what these four would be spending most of their time doing.
Okay. And then lastly, in the health department, so this is 30% from GF and 70% from grants, fees, and reimbursements. I mean, obviously, we need this position. I'm a little shocked that we didn't think of this a couple of months ago. Now does not seem the time to be short-staffed at the health department. But when we say if funding is eliminated or decreased, the positions will be eliminated, I'd hate to see us eliminate the deputy health officer. So can we elaborate a little bit about what that means for this particular position?
Adam London, are you started to come to the podium and then you wandered off.
So. I think this question pertains more broadly to how we handle positions across the board at the county when the funding is eliminated. And our policy, the position goes with that elimination of funding.
Oh, no, I get that as a general policy, and I certainly get it for the first two bullet points and the first five positions. But this one seems, a little bit different, right? We've had the position before, so in a sense it's calling it backfill position, which was transferred. It's hard to follow.
Commissioner, can I expound on that? Just
yeah, sure.
So, because I was going to ask that same question as to historically, has this been the ratio of funding for that position, 30% from the general fund, 70% from a collection of grants and other funding sources?
It has varied between 70-30 one way or the other. So there has always been a combination of grant-funded responsibilities for this position, depending on the grants that we have at that any particular time, and some contribution of general fund. So it's always been a braided funding for that position.
So where those grants and funds have perhaps dropped off, one or two of them, whatever they are, then we've expanded the general fund contribution to make sure the position
budget
stays?
Yeah, from budget year to budget year, yes.
Okay. I don't know if that responded.
No, I think that helps. I guess my question is, you know, if funding is eliminated or decreased, the positions will be eliminated. So I'm reading that as it's mandatory to eliminate the deputy administrative health officer if we lose some of these grants or fees or reimbursements come in under budget. And I don't want to eliminate the deputy health administrative officer. I guess some explanation of what happens if any of those things happen.
As I understand, what would happen in this case would be if we had to flex by expanding general fund contributions to keep that, that would come back to us for a modification. I think it says unless continuation of funding is approved. So is that historically how that's happened?
Okay. Yeah, just practically speaking, if at the end of a fiscal year and during our budget process we were to identify that we didn't have the funding for a position, we would look at other general funded things within our department to move things around to retain that position. And if in some we didn't have enough general fund to do the things and we had to make a cut, we would put that in our budget as a proposed add back, where we'd be asking administration and ultimately this board for a return of additional general fund to cover those costs. And if at that time the board decided against that, then we would make those cuts.
All right.
But we would have to take a proactive move if you recommended it. But if not, if you don't recommend it, then what can this board do to make sure that we have a deputy health officer?
Well, I'll let you answer that question. I think what you're suggesting is if you lose some funding and you determine you don't need an administrative assistant anymore, you could come back and just not ask for funding for
That's
it.
Correct.
That's not going to happen, is it?
That will not happen under my watch.
So is that, I mean, I assume that's, but at the same time, if for some reason you concluded you didn't, this board would still have the capacity to say, but you're going to have an administrative assistant, we're going to fund it.
Also true, yes.
Right, but this is not really an administrative assistant position, right?
Correct, it's not.
It's a deputy administrator, excuse me.
Right. Yeah. Okay, all right, thank you, Chair. Okay.
Yes, Commissioner Hennessy.
I'm having some trouble understanding these positions. The Indigent Defense Administrative Analyst, that office has really been created within the last year. Can you provide me an overview of exactly who we've hired and how that office exists now and where you're expecting it to go?
The only person we've hired in Indigent Defense so far is Craig Paul, who's the administrator of the entire program. As the state rolls out more factors that we have to comply with, this position will assist in that compliance and will assist Craig in dealing with all of the paperwork for appointing all of these attorneys to folks that can't afford their own, for dealing with all of the invoices for all those attorneys, for dealing with an attorney that comes to us and requests a special investigator or an expert witness and the fees associated with that. So this person is going to be looking at all of that background paperwork to make sure it is accurate, to make sure it's complete, to make sure it meets the requirements of the program. So that's the analysis part of it. So that person will be working directly with Craig. Both those positions are located under the umbrella of corporate counsel because they have to, by state statute, be separate from the court system.
Will this person be an attorney?
We are not required to be an attorney. They need, if they have experience in the system, you know, like a experienced large firm, paralegal, a large firm executive secretary, something like that. It doesn't have to be attorney because they will not be in court.
This will bring this little section of legal counsel to two people.
Correct.
And you don't expect any more to be added.
We don't expect it at this point. I mean, if things go absolutely crazy on the number of cases coming in, there are factors that the state has put in place that limit the caseload per attorney. And so that could drive the outside people that we have under contract, the Office of the Defender, to add more staff there. And therefore, if there are that many more cases being handled, we'll deal with the caseload as it comes, but that would apply to any position across the county if the workload dramatically increases.
This is another one that's covered by the state right now.
Correct.
And you don't expect that to change.
Correct. The statute is very clear as to the limits of the county obligation to pay into this program, and anything above and beyond that goes through the state. Craig does a very complex grant application every year, and his application was one of the first ones approved for this year.
Follow up now, going back to the youth specialists, how did we determine that there would be four new people that would need to be added to this? On what basis did we come up, how did we come up with that number four? And I have to say, there was a passing reference to hope to increase the residential numbers, and I reacted very badly to that. Having raised three children through the teenage years, you know, we're pretty, sometimes we don't catch kids when they need help, but sometimes we're pretty unforgiving. That little phrase, increasing residential numbers, just really set me off.
Sure. The number four, actually, we're anticipating likely needing more than that amount of youth specialists as more 17-year-olds roll in. My initial request was more, but we wanted to kind of wait and see how things looked before, and how many 17-year-olds were we actually getting before we actually added those positions. And thank you for asking about the residential. Let me clarify for you, because I think we probably share a philosophy in this department. Currently, we have 16 beds in our juvenile detention center devoted to residential treatment, meaning not straight detention, waiting for placement or waiting for court hearings, but actual treatment where we're providing. We have a clinical therapist out there who does groups and individual counseling with the youth. We have probation officers stay involved, families stay involved. They're in the community. These are kids that we would typically send out of the community because we don't have those services, basically. So these kids would be going some out of state, some up to Everett, but different areas of the state. What we want to do is increase from 16 beds to 24 beds so that we don't have to send those kids. Those kids that do have to be placed in residential treatment, we don't have to send them out of the community. That was my increase. My goal was certainly not to say we want to put more kids in residential treatment, because that is definitely not the goal of what we're trying to do with that.
I'm still having some trouble finding, I guess I'm wanting to put numbers to it. I mean, what kind of, numbers to the four, the increase in four?
Okay, when I said that the four is what we would, I guess if we could only ask for a limited amount of staff at this time, we have basically three shifts per day that we have to operate for 7 days a week. Our clinical, more of our treatment work is done kind of during that first shift during the day. So we're going to need two youth specialists to handle those shifts first day. We also are going to need some for second shift. So four, I think, will handle the issues that we will need to have that third residential treatment unit staffed up with appropriate youth specialists to deal with those kids in the way that we need to. As we get more youth coming in because of the 17-year-olds, it just seems intuitively that capacity is going to increase. We are going to need additional youth specialists to handle all the shifts that are necessary to house, up to 98 kids, which is what the detention center can hold right now.
And how many do you have right now employed as youth specialists?
How many do we have employed as youth
right
specialists?
Right now, yes.
Have okay. to get back to you on that. Okay. I don't know the exact number.
Thank you.
Mr. Coleman.
Thank you, Chair. So with the change where the 17-year-old who gets caught with drugs or whatever it is, like they're going, your direction now with these changes. Is there somewhere else where they would have gone that should see a equal reduction in staffing?
I guess the short answer would be I'm not sure. I mean, we in juvenile probation, the way we do it, especially in Kent County, which again we think quite effective to deal with juveniles. We take a much more intensive look at youth on probation. So if youth are coming to the juvenile system, we're going to assess each of them through our intake department and kind of determine, you know, what services are going to most help this youth, you know, not have to come back to court. So in that regard, you know, we have caseloads of our probation officers of less than, you know, of less than 20 per probation officer so that they can give kind of that extra time and support to each case. Now, a 17-year-old coming in for a crime before might have went to district court and just given a ticket or something to appear, or they might have had to go to jail for 30 days or longer. So I don't know if it's an apples-to-apples comparison because we're doing different things.
Does, Chuck, thank
did
you.
Did you want to add to that response?
Good morning. So I guess the options at this point would have been the jail. The police officer identified the fact that there's a big enough safety risk to the public that that individual had to be taken into custody. And the numbers that we're looking at, the jail is spread out amongst where those types of individuals would be housed. And unfortunately, the numbers aren't great enough that we can reduce our numbers because we have 21 different housing units. So there's just not enough offset to be able to then offset the staffing required to watch them.
Okay, any other questions? All right, we're ready to take a vote on that. All those that support the motion, please indicate yes.
Yes.
Those that oppose say no. All right, it is approved. Thank you all for your help in getting us through these positions and responding to these questions. So, all right, any miscellaneous from members? Yes, Commissioner Ponstein.
Thank you, Chair Steck. So, great conversation on this last issue, so I appreciate all the commissioners. It's great information that came out. Just the one thing that I want to drive home, I mean, I've been here the 12 years. I always enjoy listening to the medical examiner. The things that he's pointed out with the shortcomings, we've known about for a long time. And if what he says is true, that there's sewer water down there, this is just completely unacceptable for this county, the people that work there. This has got to be moved ahead. We can't wait, and there's no reason to wait. I think he's alarmed, you know, issued the alarms that something's got to be done. Something has to be done. So thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right. If not, thank you. We are moving to adjournment and are adjourned.
Kent County. I am Kent County.
I am Kent County.
We are 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 Kent County.
Bayah, Kent County.
Ami, Kent County.
Somos, Kent County.
Mas Ira, Kent County.
We
are Kent County.
We are Kent County.
We are Kent County. Oh, yeah.